Welcome to this month's Sandwiching and History Tour for July here at War Memorial Stadium. My name is Callie Williams, and I'm the Education and Outreach Coordinator for the Arkansas Historic Preservation Program. Thank you for coming, and we also want to give a big thank you to Mr. Rick Tilley and Mr. John Latch with War Memorial Stadium, who are here today and helping us and have helped us prep for this tour and gave us lots of good information. So we have a big thank you to them today as well. As I said, welcome to War Memorial Stadium. This stadium complex was originally completed the first phase of construction in 1948 and was designed as the Central Arkansas Stadium for the Arkansas Razorbacks and was dedicated as a living memorial to the men and women who had served in the armed forces during World War II and World War I. The area surrounding War Memorial Stadium was known originally as Fair Park and was sometimes referred to as Little Rock Central Park. And according to some reports, there may have been a state fair on this ground as early as 1916, but we do know the state fair was held here in this park in the 1920s, and that's how it became known as Fair Park. The state fair was also held in other cities, such as Hot Springs, a couple of years during that time period, but mostly here in this park. During the 1930s, new structures were added to the Fair Park, including the beginning of the Little Rock Zoo, which included a cat house, monkey house, and a duck pond, as well as tennis courts, a golf clubhouse, and a traveler's baseball field that had a large grandstand. There was also, in the 1930s, a small amusement area with a merry-go-round, a restaurant, a small store, and a dance hall. The Little Rock Zoo had actually been started in 1926 with two abandoned animals from a circus that was at the fair here, a timber wolf and a circus-trained bear. So they decided they kept them and decided to start the zoo. During the 1930s, also, Fair Park for a short time was known as Overton Park, named by city officials in honor of then-Mayor R.E. Overman. Unfortunately, less than a year after the park was named Overton Park, Mayor Overman displeased city officials by pushing for the current city manager style of government and the city council took revenge by renaming the park Fair Park. In 1936, a visit by President Franklin Roosevelt to celebrate the Arkansas Centennial was celebrated here in Little Rock in Fair Park with the construction of a magnificent yet temporary large stage grandstand and sets of box seats and bleachers that would accommodate 25,000 people, and that was built here at the site of what would later become War Memorial Stadium over a decade later. Although this temporary outdoor auditorium was soon disassembled, the surrounding area would continue to be used as a racetrack for several years, with the site straddling the city's western city limits. So basically in the 1930s, the city limits ran straight through the middle of what's now the stadium. Starting in 1941, most of the land at Fair Park that was not used for the zoo and the golf course was leased to Mr. Tom Fazell for his amusement rides and concessions. This amusement park would be here for several decades, even after he retired in the 1970s. By then, the amusement park was known as War Memorial Amusement Park and was home to several carnival rides, as well as Laughing Sally, Eric the Blue Carpet Viking, and the Over the Jumps Carousel. This amusement park eventually closed in the 1990s, with the Over the Jumps Carousel being rescued from disassembly and being donated to the Little Rock Zoo. The area that had been the Fair Midway and the War Memorial Amusement Park was redeveloped as the zoo's current parking. In 1944, the city of Little Rock made an offer to host the state fair here again. But the Fair Association turned down that offer, and a year later, they accepted the offer of land along Roosevelt Road to become their permanent home. Also in the 1940s, Fair Park was briefly considered as the site for the new Governor's Mansion, although it would eventually go downtown. At the end of World War II, two major issues arose that led to the construction of the stadium. First, the desire to create a monument to the veterans who had served, and the second was a growing need for a new stadium to host the University of Arkansas football games. By the end of 1946, the idea of creating the memorial to those who came back and to those who died was growing, with veterans groups and state legislators and civic leaders trying to find some way to do that with a living memorial, something that would be useful to the state. Also, in 1946, a football game at Central High's Tiger Stadium, then the largest stadium in the city, pitted the University of Arkansas against Rice University, to an overflow crowd. Immediately, several local business leaders and political leaders said, this is a way that we can combine these two issues. These leaders included Gordon Campbell, Razorback booster president Chisholm Reed, Secretary of State Chris Hall, and Razorback football coach and athletic director John Barnhill, as well as members of many veterans groups. Arkansas, as you know, has a long history of football. It began in 1894 when they started playing more than just intramural style football. And they hired their first coach in 1908, Hugo Bezdek, who is credited with changing the school's mascot from the Cardinals to the Razorbacks after he told students at a pep rally that the football team had played like a band of wild Razorbacks. The name stuck. By 1916, the yearbook was renamed the Razorback, and the school cheer, Woo Pig Suey, and the logo of a red Razorback were well established by the 1920s. In the fall of 46, that football game at Tiger Stadium was filled to overflowing. The stadium itself held 10,000 people, and they brought in bleachers from Russellville, Magnolia, and other places to provide 6,000 other seats. It was still not enough for the crowd who wanted to come. That same year, the team composed of war veterans and high school graduates tied for the Southwestern Championship, and Arkansas got into the Cotton Bowl. Also in 46, the need for the new stadium was highlighted by Razorback coach John Barnhill, who made a very public point of scheduling next year's game, the 1947 game against Texas, in Memphis at Crump Stadium, thus making it a home game that was played out of state. By December of 46, proposed legislators had been legislation had been drafted to direct a new War Memorial Stadium to be built somewhere within the state. While many legislators agreed, they didn't agree on how to pay for it. By March of 47, a compromise bill was approved by Governor Laney to construct a new stadium that would be shared costs between the state and the local municipality where it would be built. By July of 47, several places were in contention, including Little Rock, North Little Rock, West Memphis, and Hot Springs. And in early August, the commission selected Fair Park as the site due to its central location, natural setting, and the fact that a bowl perfect for a stadium already existed in the park. Immediately, the group from Hot Springs was furious and started legal action to try to reverse the committee's decision. The suit was fortunately soon abandoned, and plans for the new stadium went into high gear. By late August, the Little Rock architectural firm of Burks and Anderson was selected, as well as Osborne Engineering of Cleveland, Ohio. This Cleveland, Ohio company would hopefully speed the design and engineering process, as they had already constructed several other stadiums across the country. The firm of Burks and Anderson was a partnership of H. Ray Burks and Bruce Anderson. Both were from Arkansas, with Bruce being from Monticello, or Burks being from Monticello, and he studied architecture at Washington University in St. Louis. In 1917, he moved back to Little Rock, and in 1922 started his own firm and designed many structures, including the original Museum of Fine Arts and the University of Arkansas Medical School, now Bowen Law School, at MacArthur Park, as well as the Stebbins and Roberts Paint Company building, which we will be touring next month. He also designed the Polk County and Arkansas County courthouses. And in 1945, after he started the partnership with Bruce Anderson, this was their one major project for Memorial Stadium. Bruce Anderson was born in Newport, grew up in Little Rock, then attended Alabama Polytechnic Institute, and then Harvard Graduate School of Design. He was in Little Rock by 1929, and unfortunately tried to start his career the same year as the stock market crash, which led to him being a draftsman for an architecture firm for many years, and before working with several other architects, and then working on war projects with Allied Architects Group. He then served in the U.S. Army as a captain, and was stationed as a chief of engineering branch at Pine Bluff Arsenal, then partnering with H. Ray Burks in 1945. Burks died in 1948, severing the partnership, and as I said, this was their one major project together. Both Burks and Anderson are credited in the reporting on the stadium as being its main designers and their main force behind the idea for the stadium to use as many Arkansas-sourced products as possible, especially the aluminum seen throughout the design, including on the front of the stadium. After the completion of the stadium, Anderson would continue his practice until the 1980s and would work on several collegiate projects at UCA and at Searcy as well. He passed away in 1985. As I said, the design of the stadium took advantage of the already existing natural depression of the site to create a large bowl composed of two separate sections of tiered concrete supporting bleachers to the east and west, with original seating capacity of just over 31,000. It did not have a track, and this was so the fans could be as close as possible to the action that was going on the football field. And the main entrance is on the east facade, with a raised and extended bay, with art patterns and art deco design features. Above the main entry gate, which we'll see, is the War Memorial Stadium, spelled out in large aluminum letters, while three large aluminum plaques depict football players in action. Also, the large roll-up doors seen throughout the stadium are original. The two wings were completed in 1948, and they were designed so that the end zone seating sections could be used for bleachers at first, but then completed at a later date to see the bowl that we see today. The stadium has been identified as both Art Deco and Art Modern in styles of architecture. The Art Modern and Art Deco styles grew out of the European Expressionism in art designed after World War I. Art Deco grew out of the new aesthetic that combined fine craftsmanship, rich materials, and new sleek forms, and was named after the design exposition of the Arts Decoratifs in France in 1925, and it inspired an internationally popular style. The Art Modern style, a little later, which is often more associated with horizontal designs and the streamlined look. It focused on the aesthetics of speed and efficiency, finding inspiration in streamlined forms in new commercial materials, and especially in product designs like steamships or ships and trains and automobiles. The streamlining of Art Modern style followed during the 1930s and influenced industrial designs. The lack of construction of major architectural products during the Depression years also led to the Art Modern being seen in consumer products like storefronts and interior decor. The War Memorial Stadium, with its use of large-scale sleek signage and large figural decorative aluminum panels along the facade, echoes earlier Art Deco traditions, while the rounded features of the stadium and the horizontal band seen on the original stadium along the entire facade are Art Modern motifs. War Memorial Stadium is one of the many stadiums built across the country during 1948 and 1949. News reports noted that over $30 million was being spent on new athletic plants across the country. That's about $300 million today. With War Memorial costing just over $1 million to complete, now about $12 million. With just over 9 months of construction since the beginning of the project, the stadium was barely finished in time for the first home game in 1948. September 18, 1948, a game was against Abilene Christian. The final cost of the stadium was roughly $1.25 million, and it was reported that although most of the stands was completed, the concession stands and some of the restrooms were still unfinished at the time of the game. Also, the exterior of the facade also didn't have many of its windows in the first game either. It's also to be noted that when the stadium opened, it was at least partially segregated during its first years of use. And many of the newspaper reports, it notes that there were bathrooms for African Americans in one part of the stadium and bathrooms for whites in another part of the stadium. So it was a segregated facility when it opened. Before the kickoff of the game, Maurice Quincy Britt, former Razorback star and war hero, performed the formal dedication for War Memorial Stadium. He was from Lono, and he was a Congressional Medal of Honor winner who had lost an arm in the Italian campaign. And he stated to the crowd of just over 27,000 people that, quote, "The memory of her native sons and daughters who have given so much that we might have our freedom," end quote, was seen in the stadium being built. He also noted that, quote, "The state could give no more fitting or appropriate memorial to her dead of the two world wars. A stone monument may commemorate the heroic deeds of Arkansas boys and girls who gave their lives, but such a shaft is not a living thing. Neither is an athletic field nor a stadium. However, a stadium comes alive on days like today," end quote. After Britt's address, the flag was raised by a color guard, and a group of at least 30 high school bands played the national anthem simultaneously The crowd at the game was apparently a sight to see, with newspaper accounts noting that during the hot summer afternoon, the crowd was, quote, attired in new suits with the smartest of new accessories and the season's unusually becoming small hats. Gals of all ages did Arkansas proud. Also, quote, a stubborn majority clung to their summer clothes, chambray and seersucker dresses. Others, including the wife of a well-known businessman, wore pajamas and straws as confidently as if it had been July, end quote. I'm kind of assuming they mean that she was in a linen suit with a straw hat, but I'm not sure what they mean when they say pajamas. At halftime, three fire planes of the National Guard flew up low over the stadium. And during the game, Arkansas showed off its new innovation for the year, separate dedicated groups for offense and defense. And they bested Abilene Christian 40-6. In 1949, for the next year, another dignitary visited Little Rock to dedicate the entire park as War Memorial Park. President Harry S. Truman, who was visiting Little Rock to attend his annual reunion of the 35th Infantry Division, Truman's World War I outfit, walked as part of the parade and then spoke at the stadium during the formal ceremonies of the park's dedication on June 11, 1949. His address was carried nationwide on a radio broadcast and replayed on newsreels across the country. If you'd like to see a copy of that newsreel, the stadium's Facebook page actually has a link to another group that has found that newsreel and put it and digitized it and put it online, so you can see Harry Truman speaking at the stadium. He noted that, quote, we are here to dedicate this beautiful park to the dead of two world wars, whose memories we should always hold dear. The brave men who lost their lives in these wars would approve of the way you have chosen to honor them. This park will be a place of rest and recreation. It is fitting that a war memorial should be something that can be used and enjoyed by the people. Nothing could be more appropriate than to devote a war memorial to those values of human life which our soldiers died to preserve, the values of freedom and peace, end quote. In 1949, the National Football League also used War Memorial Stadium for a game against the Philadelphia Eagles and the Los Angeles Rams, with former Arkansas Razorback Clyde Snackover Scott playing for the Eagles. The first night game took place in 1969, and since its opening, the stadium has hosted over more than 200 Razorback football games, as well as games by other Arkansas colleges and institutions, including Arkansas State, UCA, University of Arkansas Pine Bluff, and several NCAA Division II schools in the Gulf South Conference. The stadium also hosts a variety of school football teams, including the Salt Bowl between rivals Benton and Bryant, as well as a variety of other high school competitions and athletic camps. Also, the Rangers of the National Premier Soccer League play here as their home stadium. While the stadium is also associated with sporting events, it's also hosted other entertainments, including concerts by the Rolling Stones, Billy Joel, Elton John, the Eagles, George Strait, and even NSYNC. In 2017, concerts returned to War Memorial Stadium with a performance by Guns N' Roses, which was enjoyed by a crowd of over 25,000 fans. Another distinguished event included the two revivals held here by Reverend Billy Graham, one in 1959 and one in 1989. The 1959 event is thought to be the first time that the seating in War Memorial Stadium and the entire stadium itself was fully desegregated, as Billy Graham insisted, despite pressure from local authorities, due to the charged atmosphere surrounding the ongoing Little Rock Central desegregation crisis. As I said, the stadium is a late example of Art Deco and Art Modern styles, and it has undergone some significant changes since its original construction. A large percentage of its original features have been obscured by the addition of the larger press box and elevator shaft, and we're actually going to get to see that today as well. The press box was rebuilt in 2010 during a major renovation of the stadium. And in the late 1950s, the north and south end zone seatings were built and later attached to the east and west sides to complete the entire enclosed playing field. The stadium was listed in the Arkansas Register of Historic Places in 1998. In September of 2008, the city rededicated the stadium on its 60th anniversary and opened a new privately funded Sturgis Veterans Plaza to the west of the stadium, which you saw driving in. The centerpiece of this plaza is the 25-foot sculpture known as Stars and Stripes, by Colorado artist Kathleen Karakoff. Over the last year, the stadium has undergone a new improvement campaign with updates to the internal systems, the playing field, and locker rooms. And today, the seating capacity of the stadium stands at 54,120. The stadium also includes large spaces that are available to the public for rent for special occasions and meetings, including the press box, which we'll see later, and the Letterman's Club. In 2017, Governor Hutchinson signed a bill that placed the stadium under the direction of the Arkansas Department of Parks and Tourism. I would like to again thank the staff for helping us today and providing us with such good information and access to, this, to the stadium. Mr. Tilley stated while I was here earlier that they are, quote, in the memory business, and that's very true. The stadium has provided lots of memories for lots of people.